So we have divided the agenda for today's webinar into two parts. One is for the income tax, wherein I'll cover all this discussion into these 10 chapters: overview, tax rates, business income, capital gains, other sources, charitable trust, deductions, TDS, TCS, return of income, assessments, and appeals. And then next part, later part of this presentation, you'll get to know about the changes in the GST laws, custom laws, a new infrastructure development cess, amendment in Central Sales Tax Act. And this part of the webinar will be taken by Mr. V.S. Date. And for the income tax, I'll be your host for next around 1 and 1.5 hours. So let's start with the income tax. So let's have an overview of the finance bill. So though there are more than once, there are around 160 clauses in this finance bill and 7 schedules. But if I talk about the changes relating to the income tax or the direct taxes, there are 86 clauses which have the impact on the direct taxation. Out of these 86 clauses, 79 clauses are relating to the income tax, and the remaining 6 are relating to either to Vivad Se Vishwas Act or the Equalization Levy or IDS scheme. So out of these 86 clauses, 70 sections are they make amendment in the existing 70 sections of the Income Tax Act, while the some of these clauses inserts 11 new sections and completely substitute 4 sections. So they are just 4 retrospective amendment. That is a big relief. And another relief is that all these amendment, they are in favor of the taxpayers. So let's start with the tax rates. So on every slide, on every division of the changes I'll be talking about, so we have given a small takeaway for you so that at the end of the presentation, you will get to know at least the key points about every chapter which we have discussed in this webinar. So the first takeaway for the tax rates is no change. So there is no change in the tax rates applicable for the assessment of 2022-23. So the tax rate as applicable for 2021-22 shall remain same. And using the same tax rate, you can compute your advance taxes for the next previous year. So this is all in the tax rates. Now moving to the second chapter, business income. So resident loses, non-resident earns. So that's my takeaway for the business income. So these are the changes in the chapters or in the chapter of profit and gain from business and profession. So let's start with the first one. The LLPs are not eligible for presumptive tax scheme under Section 44ADA. So we all know there is a section called 44ADA in the Income Tax Act. So this section allows you deduction for the professional income. So till now, we have a corresponding section of Section 44AD, which defines the nature of business, which also defines the eligible SSE who are eligible for deduction under Section 44AD. But ironically, this section defines the nature of income, but it has never defined the SSE who will be eligible to claim the who will be eligible to apply this presumptive tax scheme of Section 44ADA. So now this time, so this finance bill, it has proposed an amendment in this provision. So now thereafter, only individual, and that too resident individual, HUF or a partnership firm shall be eligible to avail the benefit of 44ADA. LLP shall not be liable to avail the benefit of this 44ADA scheme. So if you are a chartered accountant and you have floated an LLP for your advisory services, so it's a big impact on you. You won't be eligible to avail the benefit of 44ADA for your professional services now. So that's a very huge relief, a huge impact on the resident SSE. So now I think you will be able to correlate why I have mentioned in the first slide, resident loses, non-resident earns. And why non-resident earns, I'll explain it in the later part of this presentation. The other one is increase in the threshold limit for tax audit to promote the digital transaction. So we all know, so last year, the Finance Act 2020 has given relief to us to small and medium enterprises if they are doing business through banking channels and 95% of their business receipts or payments are through electronic modes, then they are not liable to get their accounts audited if their turnover is up to 5 crore, turnover or receipts, as the case may be, is up to 5 crore. So now this limit has been increased from 5 crore to 10 crore. Again, another jolt for the chartered accountant. So you will have lesser client for the tax audit because now they are out of the preview of tax audit. That's another change proposed by the Finance Bill 2021. So now moving on to the next change. No depreciation shall be allowed on goodwill. That is really a bigger change. In fact, so every year we submit a lot of recommendations to the government, and we make this recommendation not on the basis of our expectations. We make this recommendation on the basis of all the rulings by the Supreme Court or by the High Court, wherein these rulings have highlighted the gaps, or wherein these rulings have given a better interpretation of the law. So on the basis of these rulings, as well as we also all the time try to make a synchronization among two provisions. So if we find that two provisions are not in symmetry, so we also develop all these points and submit it to the government so that they can bring out these changes, so that they can ensure the certainty in the law. And this, and if you guys have kept a track of all the changes which we have submitted, so we have submitted a list of around 39 recommendations to the government, and this depreciation of goodwill was one of them. So there are a few cases. So I just name them a few. So there was two Supreme Court ruling. One is in the case of Smiths, and another one in the case of Zydus Wellness. So in the case of Zydus Wellness, Supreme Court has dismissed the SLP. And then in case of Smith, the Supreme Court has clearly said that the depreciation should be allowed on the goodwill. So for those who do not know what is goodwill. So goodwill is nothing, if I say it in a very simple words, though we have a meaning of goodwill as per Accounting Standard 14, which is Accounting for Amalgamation, and Ind AS 103, which is Business Combination. So in simple words, I know some of us won't understand the accounting standard, the accounting principle, but in simple language, goodwill means the premium you are paying to the seller over the value which is appearing in their books of account. Just take an example. So you have acquired a business on slump sale basis, and you have paid 1 lakh rupees to the seller. And out of this 1 lakh rupees, 80,000 rupees are appearing in their books of accounts. And the remaining 20,000 rupees you have paid for the goodwill. So goodwill means, goodwill is a brand value of the business you are acquiring. So definitely it's an intangible asset. So we all know goodwill, which is not tangible, should be an intangible asset. This is our understanding till now, but all this understanding has been changed completely by this amendment. So the memorandum has clearly stated that. So goodwill means a brand value of the business. It means an appreciation in the brand value of the business. So goodwill never depreciates. Goodwill always appreciates, unless and until there are a few circumstances wherein you are not able to retain, to sustain your goodwill. So memorandum has, rather the department was in the view that the goodwill never depreciates, so depreciation should not be allowed on the goodwill. So what they have done, they have removed the goodwill of business or profession from the meaning of intangible block of assets. Similarly, all these corresponding amendments have been made in section 32 or section 50 or section 55. So in simple words, now you won't be eligible to claim the depreciation on the goodwill. So this is one jolt. Another jolt is, even if you have claimed this depreciation in the past, you have to add back all this depreciation to the cost of acquisition of goodwill at the time of transfer of your goodwill. So it means you will be liable to pay the capital gain, in fact, in even all those depreciation amounts. So that's another impact on the resident taxpayers. So now moving on to the next provision, which is equalization, no equalization levy on royalty in FTS. I would say this is a curative amendment. So as of now, there are two streams in the equalization levy. One is on the advertisement. Another one is on the online sale of goods or supply of services. So there is a thin gap in the services I am availing through online services and the royalty or of the FTS. Just take an example. So I am subscribing to, let's suppose, an online stock images website like Shutterstock. So the chances are it would be taxable as royalty. So we have the judgment of the Wipro by the Karnataka High Court. So whatever charges I'm paying, subscription charges I'm paying for this online platform, that should be taxable as royalty. So if you say it is taxable as royalty, it would be taxable under section 115A. In that situation, it would be out of the purview of equalization levy. But if you say it is not taxable under the section 115A, it means it's not neither royalty or FTS. So unless and until you prove it, it's a business income, then you would be liable to pay equalization levy. And again, another jolt for the resident, because they are liable to pay the equalization levy. So I know that liability should be on the non-resident because the amount should be deducted from their total remittances. But we all know that that does not happen in general cases. So the resident will have to pay the equalization levy from their own pocket. And this is always an additional expense for them. So this is the another amendment. So now moving on to the next part. Inclusive list of meaning of online sale of goods. So this time, so last time, I think a couple of months back, so we have done a similar webinar wherein we have highlighted a few points. How do you prove it's an online sale of goods? So now this time, Finance Bill has proposed a meaning of the online sale of goods, an inclusive meaning. So it says it includes one or more of the following activities taking place online: acceptance of the offer for sale, placing the purchase order, acceptance of the purchase order, payment of consideration, or supply of goods and provision of services partly or wholly. So that means whatever activity, if I'm doing either any of them or all of them through online platform, that would be taken as online sale of goods or supply of services. So now they have cleared all the doubts. Now there is no scope for confusion. So if any of these activities are happening through online impression, that would be taken as online sale or supply. Further, this equalization levy shall be applicable even if the e-commerce operator is not the owner, or he's just facilitating the sale of goods or the supply of services. So besides this, there is one more point relating to no MAT on dividend income of a foreign company. So now so that's a recommendation which has been accepted by the government. So recently, after the abolition of DDT, we have given 39 recommendations to the government, and it was one of them. So what we mentioned, that a foreign company, since they are not liable to pay MAT in case of capital gain from securities, interest, royalty, and FTS, if the tax rate as per the DT on them is lesser than the MAT rate, then they are not liable to pay MAT on such income. So accordingly, all the adjustments are made from the book profit in respect of this income and this corresponding expenditure. So we have recommended that a similar adjustment should be made for the dividend income, and that recommendation has been accepted by the government, and this change has been proposed by the Finance Bill. So now this dividend income and its corresponding expenses shall be removed from the book profit while computing the MAT. Since dividend income, so there is one condition that the tax payable on such dividend income should be lesser than the tax rate as applicable in respect of dividend income under various treaties. So we have a network of more than 90 treaties. So we have done a small research, and what we have found out that the tax rates on dividend income ranges between the rate of 5% and 15% in almost all the treaties. Though the general rate would be around 10%, but in almost all the treaties, the tax rate would be 5% to 15%. Whereas under section 115A or under section 115AD, the tax rate is 20%. Is there anything, ma'am? Yes. So now it means they are not liable to pay MAT on the dividend income. So that's a big relief for the non-resident. So that's a gain for the non-resident. So another point is the capital gains, insurance is in danger. So now the next point is insurance is in danger. So I have mentioned this insurance is in danger. I'll mention it. I'll explain it in the subsequent slides. So the first point is all types of transfer are covered within the scope of slum sale. So again, there are few judgments even by the Supreme Court, so which say that the slum sale only by way of transfer shall be covered under this scope. But now they have changed the definition of slum sale. So that means all transactions, whether by way of sale or transfer or anything. So all those transfer as mentioned in section 2 clause 47. So all the modes specified in this section shall now be covered within the scope of NumSale. So that's another change. So now next point is transfer of capital asset to partner member on dissolution of firm AOP taxable as capital gain. So you guys need to really understand why this change has been brought and what would be the impact of this amendment. So as of now, so we have a provision in section 45, that is section 4. So which says any distribution of capital asset to partners or member at the time of dissolution or otherwise, the profit or gains arising from the transfer of asset has left the room. Am I audible to all the participants? Guys, if I'm visible, if I'm audible, please confirm me on the chat box.
All right.
So thanks for your confirmation. So now let's get back to section 45 subsection 4. Section 45 subsection 4 of the Income Tax Act, it provides that in case of any dissolution or otherwise, the profit or gain arising from transfer of asset to the partners shall be taxable in the hands of the partnership firm as under the head capital gains. And such capital gain is charged to tax in the year in which such transfer has taken place. And the fair market value of the asset on the date of transfer is deemed as the full market, full value of the consideration while computing the capital gain. So this is the existing provision. So now what change has been done? So there was, I would say, a loophole wherein what the partnership firms were doing, they were revaluing their assets of their immovable property. So it's quite common. And in fact, we have accounting guidance on the revaluation of your immovable property or any of your assets. And any capital and any revaluation profit, they used to credit it to the partner's capital account. And now what happens? At the time of dissolution, so they transfer the property at a revalued price. And what happens at the time of transfer? Whatever amount credited in the capital account of these partners, they used to get it. So in that situation, they can easily bypass this section 45(4). So now in this situation, the company, the firm shall be liable to pay tax only on that amount which is calculated after deducting the amount credited in the partner's capital. So now this change has been made in section 45(4) as well as section 45(4A). So now what does it say? So now you have to bifurcate the amount credited in the partner's capital account into two parts. So the number one is you have to first create two buckets. One bucket should include all the capital assets, and the second bucket should include all those money and other assets which are appearing in the partner's capital account. So now you have to compute the partner, the capital gain from the first bucket. So while computing the capital gain, you will have to compute the fair market value of the capital asset on the date of receipt by the partner. So it shall be deemed as the full value of consideration, right? And on the other, another hand, so you have to compute the cost of acquisition. The cost of acquisition shall be computed as per the general provision. So if that capital asset is appearing in your books of account and the historical cost, if it is a land, then you have to take the historical cost. And if it is an immovable property, you have to take the WDV while computing the capital gains. Similarly, in case of money and other assets, so you have to take the value of any money and the fair market value of other assets on the date of receipt by the partner as a full value of consideration. And in that situation, the cost of acquisition shall be the one which is appearing in the capital account of the partner in the books of account of the firm at the time of dissolution or reconstitution. So it shall be deemed as the cost of acquisition. So it has also been specified by the finance bill that while computing the balance appearing in the capital account of the partner, you will have to ignore any revaluation profit due to self-generated goodwill or any other self-generated asset. You have to remove it from the capital account while computing the capital gains. So this is another change in the capital gains. Moving on to the next part, the taxation of unit-linked insurance plans. So this is, I would say, the biggest change that would really hit hard on the insurance policy, on the ULIP policies. So now let's understand what change has been done. what change has been proposed. So before I take up the unit linked insurance policies, I think I should give you a quick understanding of what is a ULIP. So basically, you can understand in a way that insurance policy, we can divide insurance policy into four parts: life insurance policies, term insurance, ULIP, and annuity plans. So this is going to impact just the ULIP plans. So what happened in ULIP? So when you buy a ULIP plan, a portion of the premium you pay to the insurance company, that is invested in the securities market. And some amount is invested, is used towards your risk coverage. So what happened in case of ULIP? So if so before that, I think I should also mention about section 1010D. So in 1010D, a few years back, I think this process was started in the year 2012, wherein if you make contributions, so I'll mention just the latest changes, the latest provision, not the one which started in the year 2012. So if you contribute more than 10% of the sum assured, then you won't be entitled to get the benefit of exemption as given under section 10 clause 10D. So it would be taxable. So now how it would be taxable? So earlier there were a lot of confusion with whether it would be taxable under the other sources or under the capital gain, but we used to take a stand that it should be taxable under the capital gains. So that this is one of the changes. So it says that whatever profits arising from the maturity of ULIP plans shall not be taxable under the capital gain. But that does not mean that you will be able to get the benefit of taxation, because all your ULIP plans will be taxable either under section 111A or 112A. So in 112A, you won't get the benefit of taxation, and in both these provisions, the gains are taxable at a flat rate of 15% and 10%. So there is one more change. So that says if you have contributed more than 2.5 lakh rupees, if you have paid more than 2.5 lakh rupees per annum for this ULIP premium, then you won't be entitled to get the benefit of section 1010D. So that whatever amount you get on maturity shall be taxable under section 1010D. So we have drafted an example. I think you should be able to understand, even if I would be trying to speak it through this webinar. So we have taken two scenarios of user A and user B. Both of them have taken three ULIP policies. User A has been paying a premium of 1 lakh, 3 lakh, and 2 lakh every year, and the term of the ULIP plan is 5 years. Where the second investor is paying premium of 2 lakh rupees, 4 lakh rupees, and a differential amount every year. So in simple words, the user 1 has paid a total premium of 5 lakh rupees, mean 1 lakh rupees every year. User 2 has paid 3 lakh rupees premium every year. In totality, it would be 15 lakh. For his third policy, he has been paying 2 lakh rupees in totality, he has paid 10 lakh rupees. Similarly, user 2 has paid total premium of 2 lakh rupees per annum, and then 4 lakh, it means in 5 years he has paid 10 lakh rupees and 25 lakh rupees and 15 lakh rupees. So let's take the scenario of user 1. So user 1, for his first ULIP plan, since he has been paying less than 1 lakh rupees, and in totality he has paid 5 lakh rupees, at the end of the maturity he has got 7 lakh rupees. So he has paid 5 lakh, he has got 7 lakhs. So whether it would be exempt under section 1010D, yes, it would be exempt, and it would be out of the scope of this provision. For user 1, his ULIP plan number 2, he has paid 3 lakh rupees every year, and in totality he has paid 15 lakh rupees. So now, guys, can I just please keep you on hold for a second, just one second. So yeah, guys, I'm back. For user 2, he has paid premium of 15 lakh rupees. So every year he's paid 3 lakh rupees. So in this situation, he will not be liable, he will not be eligible to get the exemption under section 1010D. So in this situation, he has paid 15 lakh rupees. So let's assume if the maturity proceeds are 16 lakh 50 thousand rupees. So in this situation, at the end of the maturity, he will be liable to pay tax on the capital gain of rupees 1.5 lakh rupees. Since it's a long-term capital gain, 1 lakh will not be taxable as mentioned under section 112A. The remaining 50,000 will be taxable. So now let's take his third ULIP plan, wherein let's suppose he has paid premium of 11 lakh rupees and the maturity proceeds are just 10 lakh rupees and there's a loss of 1 lakh rupees. So now he can adjust this 1 lakh rupees against 1.5 lakh rupees of long-term capital gain from ULIP plan number 2. So in that situation, his total capital gain would remain just 50,000 rupees. Now he'll not be liable to pay tax on the long-term capital gain as the total long-term capital gain in his case is less than 1 lakh rupees. So that won't be taxable under section 112. So now carrying forward the same example in case of user 2. So he has in 5 years, he has paid 10 lakh rupees and he has got proceeds of 14 lakh rupees. Since he has paid 2 lakh rupees every year, it would be exempt under section 1010D. His plan number 2, wherein he has contributed 4 lakh rupees every year. In 5 years, he has paid 20 lakh rupees and his maturity proceeds are 25 lakh rupees. So now his capital gain of 5 lakh rupees, it would be taxable under section 112A. If he does not have any other policy, then the 4 lakh shall be taxable under the capital gain under section 112A without taking the benefit of indexation. So that's the biggest change in capital gains. So I believe that it would really impact hard on the ULIP policy. So what in fact the memorandum has also stated that a few HNIs, they have been investing heavily in ULIP policies and they have made sure that their total contribution premium amount is less than 10% of the sum assured and whatever maturities they were getting were totally exempt. Though they were like you know, mutual funds wherein you make one portion out of your contribution to the insured to the securities market. So that would impact really hard on the ULIP policies. So another one is extension the time limit for transfer of residential house property for section 54G exemption. So 54G exemption, basically it provides exemption from capital gains arising from the transfer of residential property if the assessee uses the net consideration for investment in the equity shares of an eligible startup. So originally the due date, this exemption was available provided the residential property, your original asset, is transferred on or before 31st March 2021. So now this date has been extended by one more year. It means if you transfer your residential house property on or before 31st March 2022, still you will be able to get this exemption if you make investment in your startup. So this government has been quite proactive, has been quite bullish on two things, which I believe after going through all the provisions of the finance bill. One is the startup. Second one is the digital means. So, and since startup and digital means are connected, so they have been riding heavily on the startups and this digital means. And at the same time, this government has also introduced a few more provisions which would really benefit the real estate, the builders who have got a lot of unsold stocks, units of house properties. So we'll discuss this provision in other sources and deductions. So now let's move on to the next chapter. Other sources. So my takeaway is PF in EET means exempt taxable category with a question mark. So that's my takeaway. And why question mark? I'll explain it in the subsequent part of my slide. So my colleague has just mentioned me that there are a few queries on the taxability of ULIP. So I'll try to explain it in very simple words. And this time I also try to explain it in Hindi as well. So I'm not going into explain what are ULIP plans. So I'll simply clarify how these ULIP plans are taxable. So you need to understand three things. Number one, you need to first look at section 1010D, whether you are eligible to claim the exemption under section 1010D. So if you say the answer is yes, then this change is not going to impact you. But if you say the answer is no, then this change is going to impact you. And when you can say that you are not eligible for Section 1010D. So if you have been contributing more than 10% of your sum assured in the ULIP policy, then you are not eligible to avail the benefit of 1010D. So if that happens, you will have to pay tax on the maturity proceeds of your ULIP plans. Then how you pay tax on your maturity of your ULIP plans? You need two things. One is the head under which it will be taxable. Second, how do you compute the capital? How do you compute the taxable income? So I'll answer your first question. And this change has been proposed by the finance bill, that this maturity proceeds shall be taxable under the head capital gains, not under the head other sources. So you guys must have got a lot of queries from your client, from your colleagues, how the insurance policies are taxable. So otherwise, if you are otherwise not tied in, you're not eligible to get the 1010D exemption, how you're going to tax it. So the answer is, you will be taxable under the head capital gains. So that's question number one. Question number two, how do you compute the capital gains? So now we have two sections, section 111A and 112A. Both these sections are applicable in case of equity oriented funds, units of business trust, or mutual funds units. Right? So, in equity shares, units of equity oriented mutual funds, and business trust. So, now your maturity proceeds from the ULIP plans shall now be taxable under section 111A and 112A. So, that's one thing. So, you now have the section, now you have the head. So, now the next part is, how do you compute the full value of consideration and the cost of acquisition? Full value of consideration is your maturity proceeds. Cost of acquisition is your total amount you have paid as premium for this ULIP plan. That would be your cost of acquisition. This is a very simple mathematics. Just get the sales consideration, reduce it by whatever amount you have paid. So it's a very plus minus game. So you have paid 15 lakh rupees, you have paid 10 lakh rupees, you have got 15 lakh rupees over a period of 5 years. Then it would be taken as the long term capital gain is of 5 lakh. You won't get that relief of 12 months or 24 months for computation of your ULIP plan. So it would be taken as long term only if you have held it for more than 36 months. So this is how you compute your long-term capital gain with short-term capital gain. So whatever capital gains you compute, that would be taxable at the rate of 15% under section 111A, at the rate of 10% under section 112A, if it exceeds 1 lakh rupees. If it's short-term, the entire amount would be taxable at a flat rate. And all of the consequences, the computation of surcharge or the computation of the applicable special tax rates, all these consequences will apply. The availability of deduction won't be available from these capital gains. So these are the impact of changes in the ULIP plans. So I hope this is all clear. So I'll try to quickly summarize it in 2 minutes in Hindi. Agar aap logo ke paas ULIP plans hain aur aapko 1010D ka exemption nahi hai, matlab aap jo premium pay kar rahe hain wo sum assured se 10% se zyada hai, to wo 1010D mein tax exempt nahi hoga aur aapka ye capital gain ke andar taxable hoga. कैपिटल गेन में कैसे टैक्सेबल होगा? जो मैच्योरिटी प्रोसीड्स है उसमें से जो अमाउंट आपने एज अ प्रीमियम पे किया है वो माइनस कीजिए, बहुत सिंपल सा गणित है, और जो रिमेनिंग अमाउंट आपका निकलेगा वो आपका लॉन्ग टर्म या शॉर्ट टर्म कैपिटल गेन होगा. लॉन्ग टर्म कैपिटल गेन तब होगा जब 36 महीने से ज्यादा होल्ड किया हुआ है, 36 महीने से कम है तो शॉर्ट टर्म कैपिटल गेन्स होगा. इसमें 24, 36, 12 मंथ वाला बेनिफिट आपको नहीं मिलेगा और वो टैक्सेबल आपका 15% और 10% पे ही होगा. So, yeah, this is about the ULIP taxability of ULIP plans. So, that's the biggest change. So, now moving to the next part of this discussion, other sources. PF in EET. So, what is PF? So, we have basically 4 types of PF. One is a recognized provident fund. Second is statutory provident fund. Third is unrecognized provident fund. And the fourth one is public provident fund. So let me clarify it. This change is going to impact just the recognized and statutory provident fund. Why unrecognized provident fund? Because whatever amount you get is always taxable otherwise. this statutory recognized in PPF, they were always in PPEEE category. So now it would be taxable, whether it would be fall in EET category. Maybe yes, maybe no. So let's understand it how. So why this change has been made? So there are a few high, you know, taxpayers or high earners under the head salary. So what they used to do, they used to contribute a very good amount in salary in a provident fund. So last year, there was a similar amendment that now you can, if your employees contribute more than 7.5 lakh rupees, then the additional amount would be taxable in the hands of the employees. So now this is another impact. So it says it's not about employer's contribution. It's about your contribution as an employee. So if you have contributed more than 2.5 lakh rupees in your own provident fund account, let's suppose, just take an example, you have contributed 3 lakh rupees. Though the withdrawal at the time of maturity or retirement or as the case may be, the amount would remain exempt as far as your contribution or employer's contribution is concerned. But the interest component on the employee's contribution shall now be partially taxable. And how it shall be partially taxable and in which year it shall be partially taxable. Let's understand it with the help of an example. Let's suppose you have contributed 3 lakh rupees to your own provident fund account. So now whatever interest accrues on your contribution up to 2.5 lakh rupees shall remain exempt. And whatever interest accrues on your contribution in excess of 2.5 lakh rupees, in our example, on 50,000 rupees, shall be taxable. And again, under which head? It should be taxable under the other sources. So now the next question arises is whether this I am liable to pay tax again on this interest income of my previous year contribution of 50,000 rupees. I don't have any answer. In fact, the changes proposed by the finance bill, even they don't have the answer, because the CBDT may subsequently specify the manner how you are going to calculate this interest income. So it's and again, that would be a major, you know, pain area, a headache for the employees, how they are going to compute it, because every year this interest shall be taxable on accrual basis. If we say it is taxable under the other sources and employees are following accrual basis of accounting for their other income, then they will be liable to pay tax on such income in the same year itself. So let's take that example further. So in year one, I have contributed 3 lakh rupees. Now I'm liable to pay tax on the interest amount, which is corresponding to the 50,000 rupees. So now, for simple calculation, I would say 10%. So on 50,000 rupees, the contribution the interest income is 5,000 rupees. So now I'll be liable to pay tax on that 5,000 rupees. So now what will happen to my PF account? My PF account will be credited with 3 lakh rupees, my own contribution, plus interest of 30,000 rupees on that contribution, means 3,30,000 rupees. So in next year, again, I contribute 3 lakh rupees. So now for that 50,000 rupees for the year two, I'll be liable to pay tax on 5,000 rupees. But what will happen to the interest income I earn for the 50,000 rupees I contributed in year one, as well as interest on those interest component which was credited to my account in the last year? So for your understanding, means 50,000 rupees of last year plus 5,000 rupees of last year means 55,000 rupees, means 10% on those 55,000 rupees means 5,500 of last year plus 5,000 of current year means 10,000 rupees, 10,500 rupees of total interest. Whether it should be taxable, I am not saying so. That's my confusion. And in fact, I just wanted to pass on this confusion to all the participants so that they can think about it, they can write about it, they can get it published in Taxman, they can suggest their own way so that we can give a recommendation to the CBDT so that they can understand, they can take care of all the thought process submitted by all the participants. So maybe the CBDT will subsequently come out with a proper rule for the computation of income in such cases. So now going back to another change which has been made, though this provision is applicable for both 43CA as well as Section 56(2), means other sources and PGBP. So you guys know about safe harbor limit. So what is safe harbor limit? So I'll just take an example. You'll be able to understand it in a better manner. I have bought a house property, let's suppose a flat in a society, and the value of that flat is 50 lakh rupees, but the stamp duty value of that flat is 60 lakh rupees. So now there is a gap of 10 lakh rupees, means 20%. So now this, and it's quite common. So in fact, I have experienced the same thing when the stamp duty value was actually higher than the fair market value, the actual value. So in that situation, I need to pay tax on as the stamp duty as well as pay tax under the Income Tax Act on 60 lakh rupees. So to understand users' problem, a few years back, the Finance Act introduced a safe harbor limit of 5%. Subsequently, it was raised to 10%. I think this happened last the last Amendment Act, which was passed by the Parliament during this pandemic. So this 5% was raised to 10%. It was passed in the Finance Act 2020. So in this pandemic, they have issued a press release that this limit shall be raised to 20%. Now they have given a legal impact, a statutory face to this announcement made through the finance bill, through the press release. Now it would be 20%. So now what will happen? So this safe harbor limit of 5% was raised to 10%. Now it has been raised to 20%. So it means if the difference in the actual sale consideration and the stamp duty value is up to 20%, then you can safely assume that the actual transaction value is the full value of consideration, both for section 56, which is applicable in case of buyer, and 43CA, which is applicable in case of seller, if it's a developer or builder. So in that situation, 43CA, because for them such properties are inventory for them. But there's a catch. This change is not applicable for everyone. There are some conditions to it. So that condition, what it condition says, there should be a transfer of residential unit. So if any other asset is transferred, maybe a commercial space, then you won't have this benefit of safe harbor limit of 20%. Another condition, this transfer should happen between 12th November 2020 and 36 June 2021. So if you transfer your asset on or before 11th November or after 1st July 2021, then again you cannot have this benefit of 20% safe harbor limit. 10% shall be applicable in your case. Another condition is it should be by your first time allotment. So the benefit, the purpose of this amendment was to give relief to the builders and to the developers, not to the reseller. So if you have booked a flat, so I can continue the example we have taken. I have booked a flat of 50 lakh rupees and I transfer it in, let's suppose, 52 lakh rupees. So in that situation, I won't get the benefit of this amendment. I'll be liable to pay capital gain, assuming 60 lakhs is my full value of consideration. And the last condition is the consideration received or accruing as a result of such transfer should not exceed 2 crore rupees. If it happens, if it exceeds 2 crore rupees, then the capital gain shall be computed with taking that the stamp duty value as the full value of consideration, then 20% safe harbor limit will not be available. So that's another change. So these are the two major changes under the capital gains. Now moving on to the next one, charitable trust. And my takeaway is to control the trust. How you can control the trust? So all the changes which have been proposed by the finance bill, they just wanted to have an additional eye on charitable trust because there have been a lot of loopholes. So if you understand, if you believe that the Income Tax Department does not know all about our tax planning, so since they know how to make the law, so they also know how to plug the loopholes. So all those changes, a few of them are to plug the loopholes, but one of them is if they have taken back something, so they have given you something. So the first one is no set off. I think before the first point, I should take the second point first. So the amount applied out of loan shall not be considered as application of income. So now what used to happen? If you have taken loan from your trustees or from your family and friend network, you could easily, you were actually claiming it as application of income. The trust was actually claiming it as application of income. So now this finance bill has proposed to plug this loophole. Now they say whatever amount you use out of your borrowed fund shall not be taken as your application of income. You can claim it as application of income when you actually make the repayment of your loan or borrowing amount. So let's take an example. Your voluntary contribution, let's suppose your voluntary contribution during the year is 10 lakh rupees. You have borrowed 5 lakh rupees during the year. Now you have total fund of rupees 15 lakh rupees. You have applied 5 lakh rupees out of your total funds, which is 15 lakh. And out of this 5 lakh, you have applied just 3.5 lakh rupees out of your borrowings, out of your 5 lakh, sorry, I just reiterated my example. So you have total receipt of 10 lakh rupees. Your total application of income is 8.5 lakh rupees. Out of this 8.5 lakh rupees, you have used 5 lakh rupees from your non-corpus contribution and 3.5 lakh rupees from your borrowings. So now, it means you have total receipt of 15 lakh, 10 lakh voluntary contribution, 5 lakh loan, utilization 8.5 lakh, 5 lakh out of non-corpus contribution and 3.5 lakh out of borrowings. So now, before this amendment, your total application of income, your total taxable income would be nil. How? Your receipts is 10 lakh because loans are not your receipts, it won't be taxable. Your application of income is 8.5 lakh, even if it has been used out of borrowed fund. And 15% of your total voluntary contribution as your deemed application means 1.5 lakh rupees. Means your total application of income is 10 lakh rupees. Now your total taxable income is nil. So now what will happen after this amendment? Your total receipt is 10 lakh rupees, excluding the borrowed amount. Your application of income is 5 lakh only out of your non-corpus contribution. Since you have used the 3.5 lakh rupees out of borrowed fund, so it won't be deemed as application of income. And 15% deemed application, which is 1.5 lakh, it means your total application of income or deemed application of income during the year is 6.5 lakh. Now your taxable income is just 3.5 lakh vis-a-vis nil before this amendment. So if you make a repayment of borrowings by 3.5 lakh rupees, in that situation, your taxable income of the trust shall be nil if you don't make any repayment. So if we compare apple to apple, your total taxable income would be 3.5 lakh rupees. So now it makes sense to take the first amendment. No set-off of deficit to be allowed to the charitable institutions. Now you will be able to understand it in a better way. So what happens? So in any year you had, let's continue the same example. So you have voluntary contribution of 10 lakh rupees. Let's suppose you have borrowings of 5 lakh rupees. Now you have total funds at your disposal, 15 lakh rupees. You have applied 12 lakh rupees for your charitable purposes. So how much should be your application of income? So you would say 2 lakh rupees, 10 lakh voluntary contribution, 12 lakh application of income. And in fact, if I ignore the deemed application, my application of income is 12 lakh. So my deficit is 2 lakh rupees. That should be allowed in the subsequent year. Now it is not going to happen. Why? So if you really understand the impact of this amendment, so how did you fund your additional application of income out of borrowed funds? So there is no how a charitable trust get the receipts, either by a voluntary contribution or by way of corpus donation. So if I extend it further, then by way of maybe loan, I don't think so there is any other way. Yes, it can be through business or profession, but that would be again considered as a voluntary contribution. So there is only one way other than this contribution is through borrowings. So when borrowings are not considered as your application of income, then obviously, you should not be allowed the deficit part. So you cannot avail the deficit part because there is no way to generate the fund for the charitable trust without routing it through your contribution part. If it's a loan and when you make a repayment of it, then you can claim it as application of income. So now just take an example. So your contribution 10 lakh, your application of income is 12 lakh. Since 2 lakh has been used out of your borrowings, your income of current year is nil. So let's suppose in the next year, your again receipt is 10 lakh rupees. 5 lakh is your application of income. So you have remaining 5 lakh. So now you have actually paid 2 lakh rupees for the borrowings you have made. In that situation, now your application, your taxable income in the next year would be 3 lakh. So that's another change in trust. Corpus contribution to be exempted only if invested. So what is the impact of this change? So now, agar simple bhasha mein bolu to pehle khichdi paki hui thi. Corpus donation, non-corpus donation, and borrowings. They were all part of one bank account. So there was, you could not trace which amount you have used for which purposes. But now you cannot do that. If you want to use money out of your corpus contribution. So I simplified. So your corpus contribution shall be exempted only if you make them invested in the modes as specified in section 11 and 5. Section 11, subsection 5. So how it's going to impact us? So just take an example. So you have received a check of corpus donation of 10 lakh rupees and you didn't invest it in the manner as specified in 11.5, and you use it for your non-corpus purposes, and you can claim it as application of income. So on one part, your corpus donation is exempt. On the other, another part, its utilization is claimed as application of income. So it was a double benefit for the charitable trust. So now you won't be eligible, you won't be entitled to claim your corpus contribution as exempt from tax unless and until you get them invested in the modes in section 11 and 5. So if you have used some fund out of your corpus contribution for your application of income, you can claim them exempted only if when you contribute a similar amount, you invest a similar amount which you have used for your non-corpus purposes in the 11.5 modes, only then you can claim it as exempted for the corpus contribution under section 11 and 12. Another point, so it's a big relief for small and for small and medium charitable trust and basically educational or medical institutions. So I think these are the two institutions or two industries which were either hardly impacted by harshly impacted by this pandemic, or which really helped us to get out of this pandemic. So maybe so this amendment would bring a helping hand for the educational and the medical institution. So there are two sub clauses, 3IAD and 3IAE of clause 23C of section 10. So these two sub clauses provides an unconditional exemption to the educational or medical institution, which includes universities, colleges, hospital, clinics, everything, if your annual receipts does not exceed 1 crore. So now what happens? So this set limit has been proposed to be increased to 5 crore. But that does not mean you will apply this threshold limit separately for all your institutions. You have to club them together, not only educational, not only medical, but all of them. Just take an example. You are a charitable trust which has got one school, one college, one medical college, and maybe one small hospital. And total receipts of all these institutions, let's suppose the annual receipt of each institution is 2 CR. It means total receipt is 8 CR. So now you won't be entitled to get the benefit of these two clauses. So there are a lot of judgments which say that you have to compute this threshold limit for each institution separately. So we have a Karnataka High Court judgment in the case of Children's Education Society, 34 taxman.com 285. So now all these rulings and case laws have been overruled by this amendment. So now you have to club them together while computing if you are entitled to get the benefit of exemption under section 1023C, 3IED, and 3IE. So now you would say that though they have given some relief, but they have taken something back. So that's why I think you will be able to correlate my one takeaway to control the trust. Deductions. In simple words, there is nothing much to explain, but in simple words, more time to invest. How? ATIBA. So this section allows deduction to the companies who are into building affordable housing projects. So they were entitled to get this deduction if their housing projects are approved on or before 31st March 2021. This date has been extended to 31st March 2022. There is one more change in this section. Now all those companies who are building the affordable renting housing, because that is a really pain area for the migrant laborers, now they will be entitled to get this deduction, and subject to various conditions that their rental housing project should also be approved by the prescribed authority. That's one change. Another one is ATIC. So we have just discussed a couple of minutes back about 54GB. So a similar amendment has been made, wherein 1 year extension has been given for the incorporation of a startup to claim the deduction under section 80IAC. So as per the existing provisions, so if you have incorporated on or after 1st April 2021, you were not entitled to get the deductions. But now this outer date has been extended by another 1 year. So now you can incorporate your startup on or before 31st March 2022. Another change in ATEEA, again, that is for the housing companies. So as per ATEEA, so an individual gets a deduction of up to 1.5 lakh rupees. That's an additional restriction in addition to section 24. If the loan is sanctioned is on or before 31st March 2021, the value of the house is up to 45 lakh rupees, then you could claim a deduction under section ATEEA. Provided the loan should be sanctioned on or before 31st March 2021, this outer date has again been extended by 1 more year. So now, even if your loan is sanctioned by 31st March 2022, you could avail this. You can avail this ATEEA. Other conditions would remain same, that the value of house property should be 45 lakh. So that's all under deductions. So now, my again takeaway, I'll prove it. More time to invest. TDS, TCS, as well as advanced tax. One simple statement: pay more. Why and how pay more? I don't know why, but I believe that in last 2-3 years, a lot of changes have been made in TDS and TCS, which have not only added to the complexities, which have not only added to the compliance burden, but at the same time, it has also helped the government to increase the ambit of return filers as well as taxpayers. How? So let's start with the first one, TDS on purchase of goods. I hope you will feel that this word is quite familiar and similar. Yes, last year they made a similar amendment in section 206C clause 1H, which is TCS on sale of goods. So it's entirely its opposite of that change which was made last year. Now there is a TDS on purchase of goods. Earlier TDS on sale of goods, now TDS on purchase of goods. That section still remains. And what is the difference between these two provisions? So it's better. More or less they are same, but there are few more changes, yet very essential changes. So you will be able to understand this provision if I compare it with 206C1H. Who is liable for deduction of tax under new section? Buyer. Who is liable for collection of tax under previous section 206C1H? Seller. What is the turnover limit of deductor or collector under new section of 194Q? 10 crores. Under 206C1H of the seller, 10 crore. So you will have to see the turnover of buyer in case of TDS, turnover of seller in case of TCS. What is the threshold limit for deduction of tax or collection of tax? In both the cases, 50 lakhs. Purchase value should exceed 50 lakh, sale value should exceed 50 lakh. Though they are second aspect of any transaction. So every purchase has got its corresponding sale. What is the rate of TDS and TCS, 0.1%. Amount on which tax to be deducted and collected. Now please hold. There is a change. 206E1H says on the entire consideration received from the sale. So if your sale is 60 lakh rupees, 50 lakh rupees or 60 lakh rupees and you receive, let's suppose during the year 55 lakh rupees, you will have to collect tax on the total amount. But in TDS, you will have to collect, deduct the taxes only on the amount which is in excess of 50 lakh rupees. So that's a biggest change in case of TDS on the total amount or in excess of 50 lakh, in case of TCS on the total consideration received. When the tax should be deducted or collected, TDS says at the time of credit or payment, as usual, whichever is earlier. TCS says at the time of receipts and not otherwise, and not in case of debit. Who should be given preference? Let's suppose these two sections are applicable in case of buyers as well as sellers. The preference shall be given to the buyer. Means if two business houses are dealing with each other, then it's the buyer who will deduct the tax and not the seller. If buyer does not do that, then seller will do that. Let's take an example. We have taken three scenarios. Turnover of seller 12 crore, 6 crore and 12 crore. Turnover of buyer 6 crore, 12 crore and 12 crore. So let's take each scenario one by one. Turnover of seller 12 crore, turnover of buyer 6 crore. Means turnover of seller is more than 10 CR. Now who will be liable to collect the tax? It's seller. Let's suppose sale of goods is 2 CR. Let's suppose sales consideration is 1 CR. Now the seller will collect tax only on 1 CR, which is just 10,000 rupees. Not the total amount of sale of goods. Let's take scenario 2. Turnover of seller 6 CR. Turnover of buyer 12 CR. Who will be liable to deduct the tax? It's buyer. TCS will not be applicable. Sale of goods is 2 CR. Consideration received is 1 CR. Now, what do you think? How much tax should be deducted? So it would be deducted on 2 CR minus 50 lakh. Means 1.5 CR. Means tax to be deducted under at the rate of 0.51% means 15,000 rupees. So let's suppose the turnover of buyer and seller is equal to 12 CR. Sales value 2 CR. Consideration received 1 CR. Who will be liable? It's the buyer. Rate of tax 0.1%. Amount of tax 15,000 rupees. So in same example, so if buyer is liable, tax to be deducted 15,000. If seller is liable, tax to be collected 10,000. So that's a change in these two provisions. So that's the biggest, I would say. So last year, we were trying to recover from this trauma. Now another trauma for the big houses. Non-filers shall be subject to TDS and TCS and at higher rates. I don't know how it's going to be implemented. So let's try to understand the provision first. Then let's try to find out how this provision shall be implemented. So we currently have two sections, 206AA and 206CC, which says if the deductor or collector does not furnish his PAN, then the tax shall be deducted at a higher rate. What is that higher rate? So we generally believe that is 20% or 5%, as the case may be. So in case of 194N, wherein the tax rate is 1% or 2%, but if PAN is not furnished, it becomes 5%. So there are a lot of sections. So generally, it's 20% to 5%. And the similar provision we have in case of TCS, which is 206CC. So now what they have done, they have made one more change. So now it says, if the deductor or collector does not furnish his return of income consecutively for 2 years, in that case, the TDS shall be deducted or TCS shall be collected at a higher rate. How it's going to happen, I don't know. Maybe I don't have the answer. So they have done a similar thing, I think, with 194N. They have given a functionality for the banks wherein they can easily check, and they have, I think, to verify the PANs on bulk basis. Maybe that functionality will be given to the normal general taxpayer as well, but it would be really cumbersome for you if you need to check for section 192, 194C or 194A or 194I, which are very common sections, 194J, whether the deductee has furnished the return of income for last 2 years or not. So that's really a big pain area and headache for the deductor. But this section will not be applicable in case of 192, 192A, 194B, 194BB, 194LPC, 194N. Because 194N, you already have a similar provision. So 192 is for salary, 192A is for taxability in case of withdrawal from the provident fund. At least 192 is a big relief because even a small taxpayer, even if they don't pay anything, they generally pay salary, and salary would be generally subject to TDS even if the deductor is not subject to tax on it. TDS at a concessional rate on income from units held by FPIs. So we have also recommended this change to the government, which has been accepted. So what does it say? It's a very simple thing. So if your interest income are taxable at a rate which is less than the rate as specified under section 115(80), which is applicable in case of FPI, which is basically 20%, but the tax rate under the relevant DTA, which generally falls in the range of 10% and 15%, then the tax shall be deducted at the rate as specified in the DTAA, but there are a few conditions to it that he needs to furnish a few documents. So that's a change in the TDS rate in case of interest payable to the FPIs. Now, TDS on dividend distributed by SPV to business trust, that is again one of the recommendations which we have given to the government. Since the income of the unit holders of a business trust are taxable under pass-through taxation regime, means whatever income distributed by the business trust, the unit holder, is taxable in the hands of the unit holders. I won't say whatever, a certain incomes. So what happens if a business trust gets some dividend income from the SPV? That dividend income is subject to TDS under section 194, because there is no exemption for the SPVs. So what happens if 100 rupees SPV declares a dividend, business trust get just 90 rupees, or maybe that distribute just 90 rupees to the unit holders. So, but now what happens is that rupees shall anyways taxable in the hands of unit holders. So that does not make sense. The SPV should deduct taxes out of such distribution of dividend. So now there is an exemption. Now business trust would get the income without reduction of tax, and SPV will not be required to deduct the tax, and they can distribute the complete amount to unit holders. Now moving on to the next part, relief from interest for any deficit in the advance tax liability due to dividend income. So that is again one of the recommendations which we have given to the government. So that means whatever dividend income you are getting, so after abolition of DDT, or rather before abolition of DDT, there were basically three references in the chapter relating in the chapter relating to interest. So 234C interest is payable if you didn't pay your installments or advance tax fully, or there was deficit in the payment of advance tax. So, but there were few exceptions to it. So you could reduce your advance tax liability by capital gain, by your windfall gain like lottery income, hair sources income, or your dividend under section 115 BBDA. But after abolition of DDT, 115 BBDA does not make any sense. And since they forgot to make the consequential amendment in 34C, then the dividend income should also be excluded, because taxpayer generally, a shareholder generally cannot expect the amount of dividend he'll be expecting. So he should not be penalized by way of interest for any shortfall in the payment of advance tax. So now they have accepted this recommendation. You can remove this dividend amount from your advance tax liability. So now you will not be liable to pay 234C, provided you pay the advance tax liability in the next installment. So that's all changes in TDS. That means, as I mentioned, pay more. Return of income. So now less time for everyone. Why I say less time of everyone? So I'll try to explain it with the help of a table, and you'll be able to understand it in a better way. You'll be able to have a holistic view of all the changes made in the return of income as well as assessment of income. But I think I should mention about one change which is going to impact the resident senior citizen. So now we used to have two definitions of senior citizen. One is who is above 60 years and one is above 80 years. Now we have the definition who is above 75 years. So these senior citizens are not required to file return of income, provided they have just two incomes, pension income and interest income. Condition number one, rather condition number two, number one is 75 years of age. Number two, pension income and interest income, only these two incomes he should have. Condition number three, all this income should be credited in one bank. It can be one bank account or two bank account, but it should be credited only in one bank. And condition number four, that bank should deduct the taxes at the rates in force out of such income. So just take an example, a senior citizen is getting let's suppose the pension income of rupees 50,000 rupees. It means he has got 6 lakh rupees. I remove 50,000 rupees standard deduction, 5.5 lakh rupees. Let's suppose he has got interest income of 4.5 lakh rupees on FD's total income is 10 lakh rupees. And how much tax he would be liable to pay? So if I ignore the senior citizen concept, then around 1,12,500. So now the bank will deduct the tax at the rate of 1.12 lakh out of this total income. And if that happens, the senior citizen will not be liable to file the return of income. Moving on to the next slide. So I think these all changes are the same. So let's jump to that table first, which we'll be able to understand what are the changes relating to return and assessment. So this is the change. So the second column, which is the existing due date, you all are aware of. And the last column, which is the revised due date, which has been proposed by the finance minister. So let's take each scenario one by one. Filing of original return of income. So what is the due date existing? So we have three dates, 31st July. So all these examples are relating to the upcoming assessment year, means 21-22 assessment year, which is the current previous year, 2020-21, because all these changes in returns and assessments, they've been made applicable from the current previous year or the assessment year, upcoming assessment year. So for the current previous year, the due dates are 31st July 21, 31st October 21, and 30th November 2021. There is no change in the revised due dates. So there is no change in these due dates. That would remain same. What is the due date for filing of belated or revised return of income? It was generally 31st March 2022. Now it would be 31st December 2021. So now you would just have 9 months for filing of your revised or belated return. So 3 months have been taken away. Maybe you would have a question, what will happen to section 234F, that is the late filing fees. So there is another window which generally gets activated on or after 1st January 2021 or 2022. So that window will not apply in general scenario. But maybe if the assessing officer issues a notice under section 42 to file the return of income, in that case, that late filing fee shall be levied, which is on the higher side. Due date for processing of return of income. So it was 31st March 2023. It is now 31st December 2022. Again, 3 months reduction. Issue of notice for scrutiny assessment. It was 30th September 2022. Now it would be 30th June 2022. 3 months reduction. Completion of scrutiny assessment. 31st March 23. Now 31st December 22. 3 months reduction. Completion of past judgment assessment. 31st March 23. 31st December 2022. 3 months reduction. Issue of notice under section 148 within the time period specified in new section 149. So we used to have 4 years, 6 years, and 16 years. Now, again, this change has been made. Now we just have two periods, that is 3 years and 10 years. So they have moved 16 years. They have reduced 4 years by 1 year, and they have reduced, increased 6 years to 10 years. But only in those cases where the income escaping assessment is likely to exceed 50 lakh rupees. So in this situation, existing due date was 31st March 26. That was a typo error. That 31st March 28, 31st March 38. But now it would be 31st March 25 and 31st March 32. So these are the two dates which would be relevant for the assessment year 21 and 22. Completion of assessment, again, that is connected with the dates which I just mentioned. So these are the changes relating to appeals and assessment. So if I say so, so you'll be able to correlate it easily with the statement I have just mentioned. Lesser time for everyone. lesser time for everyone. So that's the return of income. These are the changes. And then assessment and appeals. Things more centralized now. So now they have introduced a scheme for faceless appeals. They have reduced, as I mentioned, the time limit for completion of assessment proceedings. They have reduced the time limit for opening of cases. So the purpose behind the reduction of these times are to give certainty, to give confidence to the taxpayers. If government is putting pressure on the taxpayer to be on time in filing a return of income, they are also putting the assessing officer of the department per se at the accountability that you would be equally liable to complete all your assessments on time. Then now we have faceless scheme for the ITAT appeals. A separate scheme would be notified separately. So now we have a constitution of DRC for small and medium taxpayers. So that's a welcome move wherein they have introduced the concept of dispute resolution committee. So that means if your income is up to 50 lakh rupees and disputed income of up to 2 lakh rupees, you can easily approach this committee for the resolution of the dispute. That will really expedite the entire process of dispute resolution. You may not need to approach the long process of filing of appeal to CIT, then ITAT, then High Court, and then Supreme Court. So, and then it's the same. So discontinuation of Income Tax Settlement Commission, that's the biggest change, I would say. So now you would, you won't have any chance to approach the Income Tax Settlement Commission. And in fact, all your pending application shall be taken care of by an interim board, which shall be constituted by the central government. These are all. So these are all the changes which I believe I should highlight to all the participants. Now I have the famous Mr. V.S. Date, and I'll be very happy to invite him to come and take over. And you just let him explain all the changes in the indirect taxes. And this is the agenda which I just mentioned initially. And he'll explain the changes in the GST laws, in the custom laws, in the CST Act, and I think one more CESS has been introduced. So thank you guys. You guys were really very patient. So we'll one more announcement I think I should make. So we have we have been working continuously from last 36 hours, and we have prepared a complete book of Guide to Finance Bill, wherein we have, though I could not, due to lack of time, I could not touch upon each and every clause. We have explained each and every clause with lot of examples in Guide to Finance Bill, wherein we have covered changes in the income tax law, indirect tax laws, and the corporate laws, which include the FEMA or the Indian Stamp Act. And we have covered all the detailed analysis in Guide to Finance Bill. That book would be available both on our bookstore as well as our virtual bookstore. So you guys can buy this book from the nearest bookseller or from our bookstore. And you will find a link on our bookstore as well as you will find a link after this webinar on your mail IDs as well. Thank you, guys. Now over to Mr. Date.
Good afternoon, all of you. After a good session on income tax, now we'll discuss some issues regarding indirect taxes. Of course, we'll not see each and every change. We'll highlight only major changes and which are some of the changes which are problematic and some of the problems with changes which are significant, and we will ignore minor changes. Now, one major change which is going to create the issue is regarding amendment proposed in definition of supply. Now, scope of supply has been defined to include all forms of supply, goods or services, or both, such as sale, transfer, etc. Now, this provision has been amended with retrospective effect from 1st July 2017 to provide that activities or transactions by a person other than an individual to its members or constituents or vice versa made would be treated as a supply. That is, Section 7AA of CGST Act is proposed to be amended. Now, the background of this retrospective amendment is that right from the beginning, the government has been trying to tax the clubs and associations which are providing services or food or other services to its members. But somehow, the decisions of authority of advance ruling, at least six decisions, which they say that service provided or activity or transactions between association and its members are there is mutuality, and so these transactions cannot be taxed. There is one decision of even Calcutta in Supreme Court in Calcutta Club that the transactions between association or club and its members, there is mutuality concept, and these transactions cannot be taxed. And to get over these decisions, they have made a retrospective amendment, and a new clause has been inserted, and that definition of supply would include transactions between the association and its member. And on top of that, an explanation has been inserted to Section 7 to provide that the person and its members or constituents shall be deemed to be two separate persons, and the supply of activities or transactions inter se shall be deemed to take place from one such person to other. That means, in short, all transactions between the association or club and its members will be taxable, whether you pay annual fees, monthly fees, or you take food or you take some services, all these transactions will be taxable. Now, principally, I would say there is nothing wrong with this provision, because right from the beginning, the intention of government was to tax this transaction. If you see the definition of person, the definition of persons includes association, whether incorporated or not. The Schedule 2 also is very clear that transaction between the association and its members is supply of goods, and it should be taxable. So in principle, there is no objection to this amendment. But the objection is only to retrospective effect given to this amendment. Now, as you know, on the basis of the decision of Supreme Court and decision of authority of advance ruling, many clubs and associations have not collected GST from their members for last almost 3.5 years. So they relied on the decision of Supreme Court, and they relied on the decision of authority of advance ruling. Now, with retrospective amendment, all these clubs and associations will be liable to pay tax for last 3.5 years, including interest of 18%. Now, many clubs and associations at this stage will not be able to recover that amount or collect amount from that member, and they will be in big financial soup. Now, if you remember that when BJP came to power, one of the first promise which they have made is that there will be no retrospective amendment of in taxation, because retrospective amendment completely upsets your financial calculations. It may upset your complete financial planning. It may even lead you to bankruptcy. So retrospective amendment, particularly indirect tax, is very, very, very difficult, because at that stage you cannot collect from the recipient. So, and the most notorious example of retrospective amendment, if you know, is of Vodafone. Now, Vodafone won in Supreme Court, and notoriously, it's the most notorious amendment, made government notorious amendment, and with retrospective effect. Now, that would have made the company, may not be bankrupt, but it would have been serious financial trouble. Now, this company went to international arbitration. And interestingly, that international arbitrator unanimously gave decision in favor of Vodafone, that this retrospective amendment is absolutely unfair, absolutely illegal. And it was illegal. Retrospective amendment, you act on some thing, and then all your financial planning gets us, you become bankrupt. Is something not done. And so government should have accepted the decision of arbitral tribunal magnanimously, but instead of that, they have gone to appeal against that decision. Now, that is absolutely unfair, and it is absolutely against the clear promise given by BJP government. So, Parliament has powers to pass with retrospective effect, but there are some tribunal decisions, Supreme Court decisions, that such retrospective amendment cannot be arbitrary and irrational.
According to me, it is retrospective amendment is irrational, and it should be made only with prospective effect. As far as this is highly unfair. Now, as you know, one of the major problems in GST the government is facing is of bogus invoices and bogus input tax credit. And in that is not peculiar to India. That is all over the world. That is the major problem in case of GST of input tax credit, bogus input tax credit, illegal input tax credit, not heavily. So that is very common. Now, government. In fact, initially they had introduced a proper system, GSTR 1, 2, 3, so that there will be checks and cross-checks, so that the problems of illegal or bogus invoices should be minimized. Somehow that GSTR 1, 2, 3 system did not work. And there are a lot of loopholes, and naturally many tax people took advantage of those loopholes, and menace of bogus invoice also very common. Now, there are conditions, but it was difficult. Now, they added one more condition that the ITC or invoice or debit note can be availed only when such invoice or debit note has been furnished by the supplier in his GSTR1, and the same reflects in the form GSTR2A or GSTR2B. So that means mere having invoice is not sufficient. The supplier has to upload that invoice in his GSTR1, and not only that, it should appear in your recipient. Then only you can get the credit. Obviously, the purpose is to reduce menace of bogus invoices, and you cannot make complaints against this provision. So this provision is quite okay. And an explanation has been inserted to section 7512 that once you upload an invoice, it will be treated as a self-assessment tax. So that means if you upload in your GSTR1 but do not show that turnover in GSTR3B, even then it will be treated as self-assessed tax. And once it is treated as a self-assessed tax, the recovery can commence under section 79 of CGST Act without adjudication. So now if you just upload invoice in GSTR1 but do not show that turnover in GSTR3B, next day government can start recovery action. This is fair provision, no complaints. Now, one change they have made to definition of zero rated supply. And zero rated supply under the GST Act, its zero rated supply under the GST Act has been defined as exporter services or both. Or both to SEZ unit and SEZ developer. That is perfectly all right. Now, as per the existing provision, a registered person may make zero rated supply under either he can pay GST, IGST and claim refund of IGST, or you can claim the refund of input tax credit. You clear the goods or services without payment of tax and claim the refund of input tax credit. Now, those who are dealing with GST, they must be aware that collecting IGST paid on final product is much, much simpler than trying to get a refund of input tax credit on the goods exported or goods supplied. It's a very tedious provision. You have to submit a lot of documents, and then there are any number of issues, and getting refund is very, very tedious. So it is much simpler to pay tax on your supplies, IGST, and then claim a refund, which is much, much simpler and easier. But now, then again, this provision they have made to stop the, to curtail the issue of bogus invoices. Now, they said the only main option available will be to clear goods or services without payment of duty, and then you claim refund of input tax credit. And as you know, it's a very, very tedious provision. Only notified class of persons and notified class of goods or services, you will be allowed to pay IGST and then claim the refund of IGST. Now, yes, as I again repeat, that the claiming refund of IGST paid is much, much simpler than claiming refund of input tax credit, and quick and easy solution is there. Now, this provision they have made to get over the bogus invoices. Now, maybe bogus invoices may be about, say, 3% of the total people. So 3% of assessees may be bogus, and they may be claiming bogus credit. But for those 3% people, you are penalizing 97% who are genuine people and who just are paying IGST on final product just to avoid the headache of claiming refund of input tax credit. So, this provision, for those 3%, you are penalizing balance 70%. So, remedy is worse than the disease. Because if you're getting refund, and again, this again will be many problematic because many assessees, they have got a lot of input tax credit on account of duty paid on capital goods. Now, this capital duty on paid on capital goods, they can utilize for payment of IGST and claim a refund. Now, if they say, the government says that you can clear only without payment of duty and claim refund of input tax credit, your input tax credit of capital goods may go west. You will not be able to utilize it. So, this provision is highly unfair. And the remedies worse than the disease. Many assessees, many 97% out of 97% genuine assessees, at least 50% will suffer a huge loss because of it. This is highly unfair. And just to plug that 3% loophole, you are penalizing 75% of genuine taxpayers. So remedies worse than disease. Now realization of foreign exchange is required. It is fair. There is no, I mean, you cannot, there cannot be much complaint about it. But you, there should be provision and to pay IGST on your final product services and claim a refund, which is much, much more simpler. You can utilize your input tax credit of tax paid on capital goods, which otherwise will not be possible. This is absolutely unfair provision. Now, earlier, if you know, there is a provision that you have to submit an annual return. It has to be a reconciliation statement. And that reconciliation statement has to be duly audited by a chartered accountant or cost accountant. Now, as one of the measures of ease of doing business, now what they have said that, okay, you have to submit the audited, you have to submit the financial statement, but you have, you submit your annual accounts and reconciliation statement on your own. That is, no certificate from chartered accountant is required. So you file annual return with the reconciliation statement, self-certified reconciliation statement. Now it is ease of doing business. So now some, I mean, of course, some chartered accountants and cost accountants feel that they are losing or they will be losing business. According to me, it is not so, because preparation of such a reconciliation statement without the help of a chartered accountant or a cost accountant is practically very, very difficult. So anyway, they are going to get business only. Instead of certification, they will have to do calculation. So this sort of ease of doing business, I don't think any chartered accountant or cost accountant is going to lose business on account of this provision. Anyway, they will get a business of the consideration. Only certification will not be there. Now, right from 2017, there was a dispute whether interest should be payable on net amount or gross amount. Now, there are a lot of litigation, and in fact, government's department circular was also there that the interest should be payable on gross liability without allowing input tax credit. Now, that circular was absolutely unfair, because ultimately, what is interest? Interest is a compensation. Interest is not a penalty. So, interest is payable only on the net amount which is payable to government. That is the principle of interest. And in Pratibha processes, the Supreme Court has very clearly held that interest is a compensation. Interest is for use of government money. Interest is not a penalty. So, you are liable to pay interest only on the net amount which is payable to government. Now, finally, government, some of the GST council has agreed that yes, interest should be payable on net amount after, that is a fair thing to do. And but even after decision of GST council, the government took almost 1.5 to 2 years to make necessary amendments. So better late than, but of course, in the meanwhile, they had issued a circular that we will not insist on payment of interest on gross liability. So now they have made that change. That's a fair welcome. That is, they have promised that we will make a change, and they have made that change in Section 50. So they kept that promise. Congratulations. Now, Another which is a problematic provision is about road checks. Now, Section 129 provides for detention, seizure of goods and conveyance in transit. Means if you are carrying the goods without proper document or the payment is not, or whatever it may be. So the road check provision is there in Section 129, and the present provision is that if suppose the documents are not proper, goods are not carrying invoice, etc., then you are liable to pay 100% tax plus 100% penalty. Now the provision I have made is that 100% tax anyway it is gone, because you are anyway paying that tax through your return. So tax you pay through your return, and penalty instead of 100%, that penalty has been increased to 200%. And if you go in appeal, at least 25% penalty you have to deposit if you want to go in appeal. So now this Section 129 is becoming a tool of harassment, because there it is very, very difficult that there will be no mistake in your documents. And you make mistakes in making entry, you make interest valuation, whatever it may be. So even for minor mistake, crores of demands have been raised. And if you don't pay within 15 days, then the goods can be confiscated and sold and all that. So or you pay, give bank guarantee and pay something and then release the goods. Now, this was okay because so far the assumption was that fault is, if any, is of the person who is booking the goods. Now, they have one very funny provision that if suppose conveyance is confiscated or conveyance is seized, and if the transporter wants to release the conveyance, he has to pay penalty of 1 lakh, and then only he will get the he will be able to get his conveyance released. Now, in 95% of the cases, the transporter does not have any idea of about the goods, whether they are liable or not, what is the rate of duty, whether the documents are correct, whether the way, I mean, he get the document, the goods are loaded in the truck, he gets the delivery chalana, he is not aware of that at all. Whether now, and in fact, earlier also there are many decisions that the transporter has no knowledge about the taxability of goods. So, but now if his goods is seized, it's a big penalty. Just for practically no fault of him, he will have to pay 1 lakh and get the conveyance released. Otherwise, his conveyance may be lying for 6 months, 1 year, and by the time his business will become chopped. So, this is highly unfair provision as far as penalty on transporter of goods is concerned. And 95% of the cases, he is not at fault. He has no idea about those goods and payment and all that. Penalizing him is absolutely incorrect. Now, these are another things which you must have already read, is levy of additional infrastructure development, additional infrastructure and development says. Now, this is a new levy. It has already become effective from 2nd February, and it is levied on all import of goods, but practically they have identified only some 20 attempts. So this says is payable only on the 20 attempts, and on rest of the items, this says is not payable. And what they have done, they have imposed the says, but correspondingly they have reduced the basic custom duty, so that the net impact on of duty will not be much. There will be minor change. Then why do it? If why unnecessarily? Because you see, more the taxes, more the compliance burden. And in fact, the bane of the earlier tax regime was that plethora of taxes. Now again, you are this is infrastructure development for agriculture. It is only to appease the so the same purpose. You increase the custom duty, and out of that custom duty, you allocate out of the consolidated fund to agriculture infrastructure. Why this says is additional required? Unnecessarily, it increases the compliance cost, because any new tax means litigation. How to valuation issues come in? Is pe kya bharna hai? Kis pe bharna hai? Kis pe nahi bharna hai? Litigation start. So this is unnecessarily increasing the compliance burden without any commensurate benefit. Now, AIDC on imported goods have been addition to other duties, but the levy of sales may increase the cost of import. Minor increase may be there, but basic my objection for this levy is unnecessarily it increases the compliance cost. Just for social welfare charges being exempted on value of AIDC imposed on gold and silver. On all other items, social welfare surcharge will be payable on AIDC also. Now again, they will have to change in the program. Again, there will be bugs in the program. And then calculations, compliance, unnecessarily increases. The for 2-3 days now, there will be no clearances because unless they change the software, goods cannot and unnecessarily increase the compliance costs without any commensurate benefit. And because on advance authorization, EOU, free trade agreement, there will be no. So, unless you completely change your program, this cannot work and there will be any number of unnecessary litigation. So, you have custom duty and then you do whatever you want. Now, similarly, they have increased this AIDC on excise duty on motor spirit and high speed diesel. So, this high speed diesel and petrol, they have got at least 5-6 different cesses. Now, why unnecessarily make so many complaints? Have one duty and get away with it instead of creating so many issues and so many complications. Now, we'll see some changes proposed in customs law. Now, in GST, at least two changes which are very, very unfair. Now, but as far as the custom duty is changes are concerned, according to me, there are not many unfair changes. That is, Section 25 says the exemption. Now, present provision was that once the government issues an exemption, that is, that goes on forever. Without it is restriction. Now they have made a sunset clause that any exemption, conditional exemption notification will be only valid for 2 years. So unless it is so, there is a automatic sunset clause. Comparatively, I think it is a fair provision that is any exemption notification cannot go on endlessly. So, and after 2 years, if government wants, it can again review and extend or do whatever it may. It wants. So this, I think, it is a fair provision that sunset clause should be there. Now, whether it is for 2 years or 3 years, that can be an argument. But since sunset clause has to be there for any exemption notification, that is, there can be no argument. Now, again, there are plethora of exemption. You must have seen the customs manual. It's in two big values and hundreds and hundreds of notifications finding. Correct rate of duty is a Herculean task. And there are lot of contradictions also. So now the finance minister has announced that there are around 400 exemptions. So now she will renew and they will be rationalized. So it is high time they do it and it is welcome. Hopefully they will not again further distort. Now, again, this is sort of a comparatively good provision. At present, the inquiry in the cases goes on for years. And suppose there is, and then everybody, the assessee is kept hanging. Now, if for 5-10 years the government goes on conducting inquiry without any show cause notice, and the assessee doesn't know what to do now, whether he should pay tax or whether he should not pay tax on the further transaction. Now, they have made a provision that this section 28 maybe has been added that any inquiry or investigation must be completed within a period of 2 years. So they have given an outer limit of 2 years that can be extended by 1 year by a commissioner. So within 3 years now you have the government has to take a decision. But interestingly, now they have not said it. Suppose they don't take any action within 3 years, what will happen? Will it lapse? That specifically they should have provided that if no action is no notice is issued, notice happens, then that action lapses. That they have not made a provision. And then again, other provision is that this 2 years limit is just for issue of show cause notice. After show cause notice, the adjudication may take 20 years. So what is the purpose? If you prescribing time limits for issue of show cause notice, you prescribe time limit for adjudication also. Otherwise, issue show cause notice in 2 years and adjudication after 10 years. It serves no purpose. So time limits should be there for adjudication also. And as you know, in GST now, there is a time limit that within 5 years, adjudication order must be issued. Otherwise, it lapses. It's a very fair provision that there is certainty about law. Here, there is no certainty about law because after when the issue show cause notice, adjudication can go indefinitely. So, if they keep 2 years limit for issue of show cause notice, they should keep time limit for adjudication also. Then only it will be a really fair proposal. So, it may be noted that about time limit is only for issuance of show cause notice and no time limit has been provided for completion of adjustment. So, this provision becomes really meaningless unless you give time limit for adjudication also. Now, levy of CVD on subsidized articles and anti-dumping duty. One of the major sources of government is now anti-dumping duty, and a lot of anti-dumping cases are going from import from China. So anti-dumping duty is there, and one interesting provision which they have made is that levy of anti-dumping, and this provision they have made for anti-dumping duty, CVD or subsidized article, and also the safeguard duty. Now that is a new concept, and that is absorption of CVD. If there is absorption of CVD, now absorption of CVD, then addition or exception of anti-dumping duty, then again additional CVD or additional anti-dumping duty can be imposed. Now what is absorption of CVD? I will try to explain it in a simple exercise. Now suppose I am importing the goods from say China at 100 rupees and selling at 125. That means my margin is 25. Now, suppose government imposes an anti-dumping duty of say 20 rupees. So that means my margin comes down to only 5 rupees. If I have continued to sell at 125, and now then what the Chinese exporter says, okay, now if government has imposed 20 rupees as anti-dumping duty, I will reduce my selling price to 80 rupees. So that 80 plus 20, 100, your margin of 25 continues to be 25. So that is absorption of CVD or absorption of anti-dumping. That is whatever anti-dumping duty or CVD which has been imposed by government, it is absorbed by the seller abroad. Now, if that is done, the whole purpose of anti-dumping duty is gone, or whole purpose of countervailing duty is gone. So, to avoid this anti-dumping duty, if government finds that the dumping duty or countervailing duty imposed by government is absorbed by the foreign seller, government will further add additional duty and countervailing duty. That's a fair proposition. So, if they try to absorb, government will increase this CVD or anti-dumping to counter that absorption. Now, there is one provision in CST, and as you know, at present CST is only very provisions on petroleum products. So, petroleum, crude, HSD, petrol, natural gas and ETF, they are currently generated. Now, if they purchase under C form, they can procure the petroleum products at comparatively very concessional rate. At present, concessional rate of CST is applicable for trading, manufacturing, and also for other specified uses like telecommunication, network, etc., or mining. So now this provision they have amended, and henceforth the goods used for in telecommunication network or in mining or in generation or distribution of electricity, goods made petroleum products will be excluded from the entitlement of concessional rate. That means they cannot issue C form and get these goods at 2% CST. So they have to pay all the total tax, which is state tax. State tax, as you know, is quite heavy. So this tax of tax planning of getting the goods at 2% concessional rate, now it has been done away with. It will increase their cost. But there is nothing much to complain about it. It's a policy decision. We cannot do anything. Okay, so this is basically what I wanted to say. Thank you. Thanks a lot.